"Greetings, fugitives of Earth," the man says, spreading his hands wide. A dismayed murmur ripples through the crowd. The adults exchange significant looks. Chief Engineer Instance tries to slip out of the crowd, but she's stopped by the line of soldiers. The man smiles. He has a broad, easygoing smile that doesn't match the threatening aura of the soldiers, nor the smoking ruin of the ship behind him. "I am Commander Lum," he says proudly. "As captain of the Heliopause, I have come to render aid and bring you to justice." Oh, fuck right off, my guy. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to I Was a Teenage Exo-Colonist. This is the last episode for this week, and therefore the last episode of double uploads for Exo-Colonist. I've been saying double episodes for Exo-Colonist, but I mean, like, they are the double upload of the day. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying. I don't need to explain. You know what I'm saying. Starting next week, basically after this episode, we will be doing Saturday-Sunday schedule. That does not include the next 2 days, this Saturday and Sunday. But starting next week, you can expect Saturday-Sunday content. As much as I would love to keep going with the upload rate I have been for this game, it has been very draining doing double uploads. Don't think I'll be doing that again for a little bit, but, you know. Once again, thank you to Finji Games and Northway Games for the day one Steam key. I've been having a lot of fun with this game, and I'm really looking forward to more in the future. Even if last episode was absolute just tragedy after tragedy. First, mom died, and then... Oh, as you can see, the colony just got absolutely destroyed. All that's left standing is engineering, and thank God for that. So if you like to see this content and more of it in the future, definitely consider subscribing and... Ooh. Why were you, like, running away there? That was weird. But yeah, like and subscribe for more like this. Alright, let's get into it. Let's talk to Dad. How are we going to rebuild this place? It's been hard to talk to your dad about everything. Losing your mom, then losing the colony right after. It's too much to take. Neither of you know what to say. I know it's hard, Cal says, fiddling nervously with a tassel on his shirt. But I just think, what would your mom do right now? She wouldn't complain, that's for sure. Hey, Dice. Dice examines a bit of rubble, turning it over in his hands. I wonder if we're ever gonna find, like, alien tech. Wouldn't that be cool? Yeah, that doesn't really help, but sure. Mars crosses her arms and sulks. What is the point of having all these kudos if I can't actually use them to, like, buy stuff we need? Like, hello? It's not like I can mail order more supplies through the wormhole. Tangent frowns. I just don't understand, she says. Why now? Why does it keep getting worse? Engineering is crammed with families and what belongings they've salvaged from the destroyed living quarters. You could spend time in your crowded temporary lodgings in the classroom, or help the adults try to fix things. The only de-stressing activity right now is mourning, or we could rebuild. Toughness, organizing, kudos, and stress. Can't study. Can we leave? No, the front gates are literally still in shambles. All we can do is rebuild. Or mourn. But, like, no. The first month of quiet passes, each day plodding one after the other. You still have trouble sleeping in the classroom barracks, but there's nowhere else to go. Every day you wake with the others and try to make the best of it. Grief and anger come in waves, not just for you, but for everyone. Some days are better than others. You're assigned to help rebuild the walls. The first part of the month is spent just dragging away the wreckage, sorting into salvage or recycling. By the time that's done, crews disassembling parts of the stratospheric have delivered enough salvage that you can begin work patching up the walls. A sense of urgency permeates the crew. After everything, people need to feel safe. Dice is on the work crew with you, something he does begrudgingly. "Walls didn't help the first time," he grumbles whenever anyone asks for his opinion. "We should just tear them all down and live like the animals do. If someone's planted a bunch of buildings on my land, I'd be pissed off too." "Sorry, nope." By the end of the month, you've made noticeable progress. There are other priorities and not a lot of construction material, but when last year's mushwood harvest is done drying out, you'll be able to do more. Even if Dice is right that it didn't help the first time, it's better than nothing. Plus two bonus to pairs. Well, we've got some pairs. Not as much. What if we did that? No, definitely not. Okay. Could have gotten a 35 somehow. Toughness, organizing, kudos, and stress. Organizing is about ready to level up. Toughness can definitely use the help. We can buy the rifle now. Technically. If we get the supply depot up and running again. I wanted that gun. Choked. The sun's finally dawn again on your birthday. You wake early and climb to the top of engineering to watch the first sun's watery rays break the horizon as the wormhole recedes across the sky. Dawn should represent hope after a long period of darkness, but this light only reveals the full extent of the damage on the colony. You've been having trouble sleeping, like most people. It's hard to find rest crammed into the classroom with all the other kids and their families. And every time you close your eyes, you see... You shake your head to clear the memories. You pull your blanket more tightly around your shoulders. Not your blanket, that one's gone. And stare out as the sun rises on the horizon, meager and sickly. "Hey, kiddo," you hear. Then your dad comes and sits down beside you. "I was looking for you. Nice view, huh? At least we got a rooftop patio out of the deal." He laughs a little at his own joke, then just sort of trails off with a sigh afterward. He puts his arm around your shoulders, and you sit in silence for a while, watching the sunrise pick out all the broken glass littering the fields, glimmering like a field of stars. Neither of you really knows what to say. It's clear your dad feels he has to give you a pep talk, but there's an oppressive nature to the silence that makes it feel impossible for either of you to start. Eventually, he just sighs and his shoulders slump. "I know things seem pretty bad right now," he says, squinting into the sunrise. It sounds like it's taking all his effort to not cry. "But it'll get better. It has to, right?" You're not so sure. "At least your mom wasn't here to see this," he mutters. "That's the silver lining, I guess." You watch the sunrise together for a few more minutes. After a bit, your dad musters up a brave smile and pulls out a little box tied with a piece of gardening twine. "Happy birthday, my little rutabaga," he says. Sun medallion too. You know what it is before you open it. Your old medallion, the one your dad made with the sun on it to represent Earth, was broken during the attack. And all the chaos you didn't even notice, but your dad did, and made you a new one. It's just like you remembered. A similar design, with a wormhole this time, to represent Vertumna. You thank him, then squint out at the swirling wormhole still barely visible in the brightening sky. It's so massive and awe-inspiring this time of year, but it always seems to herald disaster. You're happy to watch it fade away into the daylight. Your dad slaps you on the back. "What a birthday, huh? Here's hoping they all get better from here." You both head back downstairs in the wreckage of the canteen, where they've put up temporary roofing with whatever tarps and scraps could be found. The colony nanoprinters, the few that still run, have been working day and night to replace the necessities of life, but larger construction projects are going to take some time. Aunt Anne has coaxed the kitchen nanoprinters into making soy gruel and pressed bars, life-sustaining but depressing. You and the other colonists eat your breakfast in stony silence as you mentally prepare for the day. Chief Administrator Seek has taken over as interim governor until the council can elect someone new. Last week they held a mass funeral for everyone who died. There's talk of turning the Stratospheric's destroyed front half into a memorial shrine after everything useful has been salvaged. There's still so much to do. The wall's up. The walls are up, mostly. Still can't go outside. Dice is sitting on a pile of rubble, looking out over the colony wreckage. He doesn't look particularly sad. What do you want? 53. So we're 15 now? We are in fact 15. Nothing new there. This wretched planet, Mars grumbles, gazing at the wreckage of the Stratospheric. That was my ship! Apparently Tanj thinks there is not enough room to think. Alright, well. Rebuild, baby. You're assigned to help out in geoponics. The agriculturalists have been hard at work trying to salvage what they can of the ruined fields and the destroyed greenhouses. There's still a lot of work to be done. Your dad has taken over as chief cultivator. Succeeding your mom was already difficult for him, and now there's this. He's never been the kind of guy to hide from hard work, but he's been pretty distant lately. Cal's working in geoponics too, of course. He smiles when he sees you. Hey, Garrett, there's lots of stuff to do. What do you want to work on? I don't think we had much in the way of cultivated animals. Maybe the hot pods, but... Or, you know, the... Hopeyes. That's what they're called. I can still equip Sun Medallion 1, that's interesting, even though it was broken and remade into that. Let's work in the fields. I was having the most luck. You and Cal are set to work in the fields. Luckily, they were mostly empty during glow, but quiet is supposed to be a season of planting. With the deep, compacted trenches where the massive faceless stomped all over the colony defenders, the fields are in worse shape than when you landed. You are set the task of aerating the soil. You and Cal trade off, one of you guiding a bot with dangerous-looking aeration extension, while the other uses a shovel and sometimes a pickaxe to loosen the soil and dig out pieces of debris. Then there's the spark snow. It will raise the soil acidity if it sits long enough to melt, and your earth crops hate that. When you're not aerating the soil, you're trying to keep it from piling up. There are tarps laid out over the fields, but shoveling the snow from the tarps is backbreaking work too. It's exhausting. Everyone is worried that this will be the final nail in the coffin for your food supply after the famine last year. Try not to think about it too hard, instead focusing on just doing what you can to help rebuild. Alright. So if we go boom, boom... Thank you. Okay. And then this will just skyrocket it? Yeah, 37. Way better than that. Defeated a faceless. Yeah, that's a 15 card. Yeah, we still could have got a 43. Excuse you. Whatever. Plus 6 toughness. You're eating in the mess tents when you hear something rumbling. Your bowl and cutlery start rattling. People look around in alarm. Could it be another attack? You begin to hear shouting from outside. Someone runs into the tent. There's something falling from the sky, they shout. It's on fire! You join the crowd of people leaving your temporary structures to gather in the colony square. People are squinting up into the milky quiet sunlight, pointing out and gesturing wildly. It's impossible to miss the thing hurtling towards you from space. Is it another ship? Were we followed? Like a great big ball of fire coming straight for you. Is this it? Is this the end? Is this the end? Typo. After all you've been through, a meteor's gonna land in the middle of your already ruined colony and kill you all? The heliopause. Yep, that's another ship! Mars grabs your shoulder. It's another ship, she exclaims. Look, look, it's another spaceship from Earth! Excitement ripples through the crowd. Could it be? You stare up unbelievingly at the rapidly approaching ship. The flames of its entry from the atmosphere dissipate, but a thick column of greasy black smoke trails right behind it. Soon you can hear the whistle of it ripping through the atmosphere at terminal velocity. That is not a controlled descent. It's an enormous ship, coming at you way too fast. The ship's reverse thrusters fire, trying to slow it down so it doesn't smash into a billion pieces when it hits the planet. Everyone scatters to take cover. You crouch behind some rocks, throw your arms over your head, and squeeze your eyes shut. You hear the massive spaceship touch down in geoponics, plowing through the fields and grinding over what was left of the greenhouses. God damn it. I mean, your food'll help. You're thrown to the ground from the force of the impact as shrapnel and small rocks zing past your head. It grinds along like some roaring monster, cutting a great scar through the colony and kicking up an enormous cloud of dust. Finally, the ship comes to a creaking, shuddering halt. You and the other colonists carefully crawl out of your hiding places, coughing and rubbing your eyes. The new ship is half buried and obscured by dust, but you can tell it's from Earth. You squint to make out stenciled letters. Heliopause. A hatch opens in its side, and silhouettes begin to emerge. Silhouettes with guns. Soldiers march out of the dust and quickly surround all of the remaining colonists. More soldiers form two parallel lines from the ship to the square. Their guns in parade rest, and a lone figure strides down the center towards you. "Greetings, fugitives of Earth," the man says, spreading his hands wide. A dismayed murmur ripples through the crowd. The adults exchange significant looks. Chief Engineer Instance tries to slip out of the crowd, but she's stopped by the line of soldiers. The man smiles. He has a broad, easygoing smile that doesn't match the threatening aura of the soldiers, nor the smoking ruin of the ship behind him. "I am Commander Lum," he says proudly. "As captain of the Heliopause, I have come to render aid and bring you to justice." Oh, fuck right off, my guy.
The Heliopause soldiers have the colonists surrounded and shove you gently but forcefully back into the crowd.
Alright, well, let's listen then.
Seek steps forward out of the crowd.
"You're not the commander of the Heliopause," they say firmly.
"Governor Eudicott was expecting Commander Morikawa."
Wait, we were... What?
Everyone is surprised. Eudicott had been in communication with this ship.
Aw, man, it's too bad she just died.
For how long?
"I am captain of the Heliopause," Lum repeats stubbornly, then adds. "According to the chain of command, we, sustained significant loss of personnel when we went through the wormhole."
Can't help but notice many of the soldiers exchange looks this time. You wonder how many people had to die before Lum became commander.
As a commanding officer, Lum continues, I declare this colony to be under our protection. As such, you are all now subject to the laws of Earth.
Seek bows. Now, they stammer. There's no need for dramatics. We're a diminished colony, as you see. Governor Uticot died in the most recent attack, and Fluorescent passed away a few months ago. Even Technician Halitosis is gone. You see, we're quite leaderless.
Wait, your mom? What would these Earth cops have wanted with your mom?
You notice Chief Engineer Instance is being held with her arms behind her back. She glowers at Lum with unbridled hatred. Lum turns to the assembled colonists.
Why don't we fix that? He declares. Say hello to your new governor.
You hear a few gasps of shock and outrage, and Lum raises his hands placatingly.
Let's not pretend you don't need our help, he says. And we could simply arrest you instead. But there's no need to demoralize your little colony further.
Judging from the number of guns on display, you don't think you have a choice in this.
No one knows how to react.
A new governor from Earth? Nearly 100 new colonists? Most of them trained soldiers? What does this mean for the colony?
The crowd disperses slowly, and the council members follow Lum back into the heliopause, presumably to talk about the future of the colony, you hope.
You track down your friends.
So, what do you think about these new people?
They're just going to boss us around. I don't trust them at all.
Tangent nods. They don't live here, they don't know what it's like, and they're just going to swoop in and act like they're better than us.
She hugs her arms around herself.
Did you see what they were doing to Instance?
The entire colony, now twice as many of you, sets to work on salvaging the wreckage of the heliopause, tearing it down and combining it with the stratospheric's remaining engine section. Spirits are high, though these new colonists from the heliopause aren't like any people you've ever met before. With their uniforms and weapons, they're more like an invading force than a rescue. You aren't sure what this means for the colony, or for your future. Interesting. As the dust settles, you rebuild your colony around this new ship, the Heliopause. The new arrivals, soldiers mainly, are aloof at first. Many see you as fugitives. What happened? Together, you build new walls, living quarters, greenhouses, and a massive bunkered garrison. The Stratos Engineering Wing is the only reminder of your old colony. The Heliopause brought enough rations for another 5 years, as well as a rich seed bank and working hydroponics. Finally, an end to the slow starvation you felt for years. They also have more guns and explosives than you've ever seen in your life. Even the ship has guns. A full stomach, a roof over your heads, and the promise of safety convinces most Strato colonists to accept the Helios. In turn, the Helios decides that you criminals pose little threat. A grudging peace is brokered between the two groups. You decide they aren't so different, really. There are even Helio children, born among the stars just like you. After a month of hard work, you and your dad move into your new quarters, and you have your own bedroom for the first time in your life. You place a picture of your mother on the shelves beside your bed. You step out onto your very own balcony to watch the new colony, its grounds bustling with so many strangers and strange new ideas. Minus 100 stress, plus 5 colony defense, that's now a stat. Status ended starving. You feel something rise in your chest that you haven't felt in some time. Hope. Excitement. What will the new day bring? Better get out there and find out. Cautiously step outside. Alright. A new colony. So that is our new creche. Or lounge or whatever. You've seen Nomi around since the Heliopause landed. They're around your age and barely a meter and a half tall, only coming up to your shoulder.
I've never seen anyone dress as strangely as they do. Are they a they-them? Indeed. Quirky non-binary kid from the Heliopause. They-them. Voice is high-pitched and quick.
Hi! I'm Nomi Nomi. It's short for nomination.
Oh, I'm gonna have to try and make her an anemone distinct. They do a little twirl and bow. You introduce yourself and ask about their outfit.
Oh, this old thing?
No.
Oh!
Oh, fuck. Oh, no. Voice is high and high-pitched and quick. I gotta lean on the quick.
Oh, this old thing? I designed it myself. A Nomi Nomi original based on the outfit Lavandula Starlifter wears in the third season of Turbojet Girl Transform when she has to work undercover as the lead singer of an idol group. They stick their leg out. Only I change the bottom part, and of course I have to wear my gaming gauntlets. I call them gaming gauntlets, but they're really EnviroSuit gloves that I modded so I could play Hollow games through them. Do you like games? My faves are Laser Fable and Dig Dig Digger Dog. Laser Fable is so much more fun now that we can play outside with room to run around. What kind of Hollow games do straddle kids like to play? Nomi Nomi stops to catch their breath, winded after their extended outburst. Yeah, let's play. You're on! Nomi Nomi helps you install it on your holopalm and explains the rules. Laser Fable is an augmented reality game where you bounce hologram lasers off real objects nearby. It's speed-based, so you're running around and bumping into each other, and there are extended house rules about when it's legal to block each other's lasers. We got this, bro.
Got it, bro!
Alright. So this is a three-rounder. First collectible use is free, so we can plus two something anytime we want. Okay, what if we go... That's 15. Maybe let's... Oh, really? Okay. Why is that better? Oh, because it gets a plus one, I see. Well, then in that case, there we go. Yeah. I like the song. Maybe we don't blow that load yet. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, boom.
Yeah, baby!
Oh, I didn't even do the thing. That's fine.
Right on, brother!
Nomi gives you a high five, then with a couple of quick flicks on their gauntlet, gives you a kudos for winning. They explain this is how they always play Laser Fable with the kids from Heliosphere.
Except they mostly don't want to play anymore. They say they're too old for it. They just want to be soldiers now. Except Rex, he's still cool.
Cool, so that's one of the new people. Nomi Nomi. That's a new person with Mars. Oh wow, the colony is bigger now. A fair bit bigger. Nemi is looking over some official-looking documents on her holopalm and dismisses them as you walk up.
Hey, Garrett!
Have a log. For old times. Oh good, a replacement log. That's engineering now. I don't know if my mother knew when I was born how convenient my genetic modification would be in times of crisis, Tanj says, rubbing her eyes with her forearm so as not to contaminate her gloves. I can work three times as long as the other lab assistants, with very little decline in cognitive function. Yeah, I got nothing for you, sorry. This is command. No, oh no, this is engineering, yeah, okay. Did we already try talking to Cal? I don't think we did. Cal is kicking a small beanbag into the air, trying not to let it touch the ground. He's not very successful.
That new kid, the dog boy, Rex, showed me how to play this, he says, groaning as the beanbag hits the ground again. It's a lot harder than it looks.
Alright, talk to Mars first.
Mars grabs your arm and hauls you somewhere a little more quiet.
OMG, she says. So I was making out with one of the Helio kids. Don't make that face, Garrett, it's no big deal. And she said that they're not allowed to use their nanoprinters for anything except uniforms?
She holds her hand to her chest.
Excuse me. No wonder they're so boring. Clothes are the window dressing to the soul, Garrett.
The colony's full of new people. Everywhere you look, you see a stranger. It's disorienting, after growing up in a closed spaceship. You never expected to meet any other humans that weren't made here on Vertumna. This must be Rex.
Yep.
You bump straight into one of those... What's up with the line across your face? Is that a scar, or did you just draw on yourself?
New people jogging through the colony.
Oof! He laughs and holds you steady, brushing the imaginary dust off of you and giving you a wide, fanged smile.
Hey, it's one of the kids from the Heliopause. You think his name is Rex?
Hey, I'm Garrett. Welcome to Vertumna. You stick out your hand and shake his, and he laughs. You notice he's wiggling his dog ears. They can really move independently.
Pleased to meet ya, he says. I'm Rex, and I love to shake a paw. I know a ton of tricks.
Augment doggy ears.
Okay. Oh my god, I'm not flirting with him.
Rex pats his hand against his cheek, looking cute and lost.
Hey, since I'm new here, do you think you could help me find the construction yard? I thought I might apply for a job there.
I'll take you there.
You walk him over to command. Everything's moved around since the Heliopause landed, but the construction yard is still in command, where it always was. At the entrance, you meet Mars, filing her nails and looking like she's waiting for somebody.
Why, hello, cutie, she says to Rex. Where did you come from?
He looks her up and down and grins.
I'm just an angel who fell from the sky, darling.
Try not to gag as the two of them flirt. You give a loud ahem and point Rex towards the construction yard. He looks back at Mars over his shoulder and winks as he leaves.
Okay, well, they're gonna be a thing. Nomi's fun, I like them.
Dice stands at the mouth of his drainage sewer hideout, his arms crossed as he studies it from the outside.
Do you think they got in this way? He asks quietly. There's a grate further in. I haven't gone in there to check yet.
No gift. I hope not, my dude. Oh, hey, we can leave. Definitely not doing that just yet, though. There's Dad. There's that one chick in the bottom right. Wow, there's a lot of collectibles in here now.
Even though it hurts, you find yourself wandering over to Geoponics. It feels not good to be here in the place your mom loved and ultimately gave her life to, but not good either. It feels like when you have a bruise and you can't stop yourself pushing on it because the pain reminds you that the injury is real. Like your mom dying is this huge invisible wound, and poking at it forces you to feel something instead of just being numb. Your dad is taking time off work. Your parents work double and triple shifts during the growing season this year, and now that it's over, it just feels so cruel. When people work hard, they should be able to look back on what they did and feel proud. Instead, there's just this huge gap where your mom should be. Find your dad sitting in your mom's personal garden. It's miraculously starting to grow again, despite being trampled flat during the last attack and neglected during the famine before that. Still, various Vertumnan flowers are starting to sprout,
as well as hardier earth ones like dandelions. Your dad looks up and musters a smile. He pats the bench beside him. You false start a few times. It's almost impossible to think of something to say when there's this magnitude of grief between you. He gives you time. When it's obvious that you want to talk but don't know what to say, he takes your hand in his two larger ones. Did I ever tell you about how your mom and I started dating? You shake your head. You know they grew up together in the first colony on Earth, but nothing about their relationship. He smiles and looks at the garden as he remembers. I always thought she was too cool for me, he says quietly. Things were... well, people didn't like us much on Earth. So she was always kind of a bruiser, always ready to pop off even when she was your age. She and Rhett were the same back then, he reminisces. I always thought they were going to end up together. Then your mom got injured when the first colony was attacked. I was working part-time in the clinic, and I guess that's when she realized I liked her. We had to apply to get on the stratospheric, he continues. We'd only been seeing each other a few weeks, so I was surprised when she said we should apply as a couple. They wanted all different kinds of family groups. Single people, couples who could have kids or couldn't, triads and quads, but we all had to be young, and there weren't many teenagers willing to commit to being, mated pair, and upped our chances to being picked. He laughs and scrubs his face with his hands. She wanted to get off that planet more than anything. I don't think she realized she'd fallen in love with me until we were already in space, he says wryly. Lucky for me, right? Your dad shakes his head fondly. There aren't many people like your mom, kiddo. You nod, surprised to feel a tear trickle down your cheek. There's so much you didn't know about her and what she was like, more than just being your mom. It's really hitting you that she was a person before you knew her, and now you'll never know her like that. There's a past you'll never fully know, just like there's a future that she never will. Your dad puts an arm around your shoulders, and you sit like that for a long, long while. No more with Dad. Like every pollen season, your dad gets the shimmer. The pollen is bad this year. Thick, heavy clouds of pink. Even your eyes are a little itchy, and your dad's not the only colonist spending the week in bed. You can hear other people sneezing as you walk through the quarters, bringing him hot trippet soup.
Thanks, kiddo, your dad rasps. At least he's sitting up in bed now. Your mom never got sick, not ever, your dad reminisces. I'm not sure she missed a day of work from the day we landed until the day she... He stops and sighs. I miss your mom. I wish Instance would find a cure already. He grumbles, his hand shaking as he lifts his spoon. 3 years and all she can suggest is bed rest and fluids. What good is all her researching if I can't fix my headache?
Your dad must be feeling really sick. He never complains about stuff. You check the temperature with your hollow palm, then dim him the lights and bring him a cold pack for his forehead. He has a crust of glittery pink gunk around his lips, looking cracked and gross, so you wipe it away. The glitter is just everywhere on him, like it's coming right out of his pores. He looks iridescent in the murky light filtering through the pollen outside.
Hey, do you mind opening the window a little? For some fresh air? Smells like a sick person in here,
he grumbles, pushing away his soup and rolling over in bed.
No!
The pollen might already be everywhere else, but there's no sense making it worse. You pretend to crack the window for him, and by the time you look over, he's asleep again. The worst of the pollen fog subsides in a few days, and your dad starts to look a little better. He gets back to work, which is good because there's a lot to do in order to rebuild the colony and get the Heliopause's hydroponics up and running. You're still sweeping glittering dust out of your quarters weeks later. That stuff gets everywhere. Yeah, we're taking care of you, Dad. You're not fucking going down. You hear me? Okay. There's
Chicky-poo over here. Yes, hello. Oh, you're not a chick, you're a dude. My bad. This new boy from the heliosphere is a couple years older than you. He's very handsome, and the missing arm gives him a heroic battle-scarred vibe. He stands tall and ready for action, even though it's a normal, boring day. The other recruits milling around the garrison give him a wide, respectful berth. He sees you staring and gives you a curt nod.
My name is Vase, Lieutenant Olivasius, he says, considering you with a glint of challenge in his eye.
And you are? How do you introduce yourself? I'm an explorer. His expression doesn't change.
Is that right? He says with the air of a boy who's hard to impress. Nice to meet you, Garrett. I hear it's been a rough couple of years for the colony. Lucky thing our heliopause came along just in time, he continues. Don't worry, we have some of the best soldiers. The very best. We'll keep the colony safe.
Are you one of those best soldiers?
I'm not flirting with him.
We train as a team, but... Vase says, then clears his throat.
Yes. I've won more than my share of zero-G judo matches and virtual riflery tournaments. Even competing against adults, he adds.
I bet I could take you.
Vase says doubtfully. Well, you're welcome to try. I hope to see you at self-defense classes.
Okay, I kind of want to do that now.
The Helios have replaced the old garrison dojo with a huge underground bunker. It's much larger and better supplied, and abuzz with activity. Soldiers drilling, weapons being cleaned and inventoried, and animals herded into cages for study. Can't believe how many soldiers are down here. It must be the safest place on the planet.
I can go exploring. Be nice to get our toughness up.
Is that it? Is that everyone?
We're only missing 3 profiles. Where's command? Like, honestly.
The new common area is a hastily constructed platform clinging to the side of the heliopause. Crews are hard at work incorporating the rigid hull into the natural landscape, creating a charming open-air place for gathering, eating, and relaxing. Just outside, you can hear construction happening on new living quarters for everyone from both ships.
Okay, but where's command?
Oh, hey. We can go up here. Oh, okay.
Notice board. How's the food?
90%. Okay, well. Colony security rating 50% orange. Please note, we will be hosting our annual Vertumnalia, okay? Council wishes a warm welcome to our new arrivals from Earth and to our new Governor Lum. Governor Lum Command, Chief Administrator Seat Command. Oh, Governor Lum, Chief Administrator Seat, Security Chief Rhett. So none of these have changed. That's good to know. Can I buy a gun? Gun! 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 Oh! Finally have gun. Gun, 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 gun. Give me gun. No. Taking Ricky, we're taking gun. And we don't need that one. We can take... I just adds a +5 to everything. Honestly, the +1 to all flushes isn't bad. +1 bonus to pairs. One less stress might build up. So now we have both our pets equipped and a gun! 93. Hell... yes. Oh, yeah, and what options did we have? We can work in the depot, or we can deliver supplies. Okay. We'll see you in self-defense later, Vase. You might make a good rival. But, we're going exploring.
I don't know if I'm gonna do anything for Vertumnalia this year, Nemi says, crossing her muscular arms. And Okam wouldn't want me to stop just because of him, but it doesn't feel right.
No, that's not the gates. Where's the gates now? Right here. We haven't been to the Wrestling Ridges or the Subaqueous Swamp yet. All events have respawned. Okay. We should do the valley and then the plains, I think. Well, with that introduction to everyone in the colony, the newcomers at the very least, we'll talk to Utopia, and then we'll call it for the day. Chief Surveyor Utopia stops you and Dice near the depot. Feel that? She asks. You can feel a kind of ominous, distant thumping, pulsing regularly through the ground. If you stand still, you can feel it vibrate up into your own body, too, like a massive global pulse. Utopia says, checking a readout on her hollow palm. I reckon it's naturally occurring, but it's giving me the willies all the same. You two better check it out. Mind you stick together and take readings on the way in case it's dangerous. You and Dice look at each other, excited. You follow the thumping, now an audible noise, growing louder. Okay, this isn't what I thought it was going to be, but that's fine. Growing louder. West until you've roughly triangulated its location. You know you're getting close, but it sounds like it's coming from all around you, and instruments aren't precise enough to help. Perception 30. Why is that 6? It's so inconsistent about what it is. Base value is 5. How? Card becomes 3. Okay, what if we do that, that, and that? Okay. That, 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 and that. Definitely ending with those two. Then that one. Maybe that one? Alright, that's making it become 3. Hmm. 32 or 29? Sure. Could have gotten a 33 out of that. You find a machine? An ancient broken down machine, like a small pyramid shaped building made from some kind of dark stone or bone that looks almost like it grew that way. Thud of the Thumper. Except it isn't broken. It's just so very old and overgrown, it looks more like a pile of rubble and roots than a building or engine or whatever it was. Still, a thumping noise comes from inside it. The vibrations are strong here, making your guts feel weird. Ugh, we don't have engineering 20. That's sad. You don't notice at first, but there's a curious path on the ground moving away from the engine. A line half a meter wide where the dirt is a little more worn and bare. It heads off in a straight line to the west, coming from the west. Marvel at it. Got 2 engineering out of it, though. You run your hand over its pitted, vibrating surface. How could something so unbelievably old still work? It's definitely not natural. And you can even see something like writing carved deep into the not-quite-rock. Dice starts making oomph noises under his breath to the beat of the thumper. It is a pretty sick beat. Eventually, you head back to share your findings with Utopia.
Totally an alien civilization, Dice insists.
Utopia scratches her head.
Well, I suppose, maybe, she says. You said it looks ancient, right? Perhaps there could have been another civ here long ago. We have found other signs, but nothing active like this. It seems to be pointing west. Or receiving something, she snaps her fingers. There's some right ugly ridge lines out there that have kept us from checking that direction, but we got gliders and motivation. That's half the battle.
G.I. Joe. She makes a note in her hollow palm.
I'll open up the western wrestling ridge for surveyors, she says, then grins. Whew, say that three times fast.
The western wrestling ridge for surveyors. The western wrestling ridge for surveyors. The western wrestling ridge for surveyors. The western wrestling ridges for surveyors. Oh, I haven't been saying the S. Fair enough, I failed. We'll have to stick together out there. Dice looks at you curiously.
Sure, if you're scared, he says.
I just want your company, okay? Why are you gonna be so mean?
Anyways, that is where we are going to leave it off for today. Reminder that there will be a brief break in Exocolonist episodes as we swap over to a Saturday-Sunday schedule. There will not be any tomorrow or the next day. If you're watching this the day it goes live. But next Saturday, Sunday, as part of our regular batches, you can expect to see them. Episodes might even be a touch longer, too, just to account for that, so that our progress doesn't slow down too much. But, you know, gotta get back to a routine. So thank you, everyone, for joining me. I hope you had fun. And I will see you all next time for some more I Was a Teenage Exocolonist.